Well, 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 here I am once again. I'm Ephraim225, and welcome to my playthrough of the second generation of Pokémon, the Gold, Silver, and Crystal versions for the Game Boy Color. Now, it goes without saying that Generation 1, as much of a foundation as it was for the series, as much as it kick-started a media franchise that rivals Disney Corporation, the original generation had a lot of, jank is the word I will use, let's go with that. So it's easy to imagine being a kid at the time and getting the announcement that your new favorite game was going to get an even better sequel. The hype must have been massive for Generation 2. And if I had to pick out which game in the main series of Pokémon is the biggest in terms of content, in terms of improvements to its predecessors, Gen 2 is definitely at the top of that list. It is a huge step for Pokémon. So, the name of the game for this playthrough is going to be similar to the last playthrough of Pokémon that I did. I'm going to play through each of the three games, Gold, Silver, and Crystal, all the way through one time, and I will try to adopt a different playstyle in each of the three games. I can't guarantee that I'm necessarily going to adhere to a certain playstyle exactly, but I do want to show off different strategies for the gym leaders at least, because in this game there are a lot more options for what you're allowed to take into each battle. I mean, just for this first video, there was actually a lot of capturing to do because there are a lot of different Pokémon available in the first couple of areas, more than you'd expect. See, before starting this playthrough, I did a lot of research on Generation 2, what's available and when, and as I researched all of this, I was actually getting quite excited. There's actually a lot you can do with these games. There was another thing that kind of spurred me to get started on this playthrough, though, and it's that, shockingly, a lot of people seem to consider Generation 2 the worst in the entire series. Yeah, not inferior, not low on the totem pole, the absolute worst. And I'm like, guys, you are allowed to have whatever opinion you want, but the worst? Like, I've been hearing so much bad stuff about Let's Go on the Switch, and don't even get me started on the Gen 4 remakes. Like, seriously? This is the worst? Okay, now I really have to play through these and find out if this game just hasn't aged well, or if everyone's just parodying each other. Yeah, it's probably the latter, but we'll see. I mean, I totally understand that this is still Generation 2 out of 9. It's going to look like a dinosaur no matter what. But again, the more I looked into the design of Generation 2, the more I started to realize that there is a design philosophy here that is very easy to miss if you just play the games like they're any other Pokémon game. Generation 2 is a lot different from the rest of the series. And I think Crystal version especially is going to be underappreciated no matter what. It's supposed to be an update to the other two games like Yellow version was, however, it doesn't really change any of the gym leader movesets, and most of the features that were added to it either didn't work outside of Japan or no longer work at all. So all things considered, there's probably a lot that both you and I have missed out on, so this is going to be a journey for both of us. You and me, Mr. Viewer. On that note, I would like to explain the modifications that I have made to the ROMs. Gold version has no modifications whatsoever, Crystal version has one patch installed that enables a previously disabled event, so I'll get to that when we get to it, it's gonna be way later in the playthrough. Now as for Silver version, I wanted a version of the game where you play as the rival who is known as Silver, so Silver version, play as Silver. And I couldn't really find one online, so I had to make one myself, and I'm not the best at modifying Pokémon on Game Boy Color, so it's probably not the best-looking mod, but I did my best. It's not really complete yet. I'd certainly love to be able to complete the patch and put it up online. It'd be nice for everybody else to have as well. And as we finally start the actual game, we can see that my mother apparently thinks I need to be told how to use a phone, even if I tell her that I already know how to use a phone. Yeah, phones were actually a big thing in Japan at the time of this game's creation, so phones are going to be a thing in this game. You can get a couple characters' numbers and then call them for more information on stuff. And this guy just physically assaulted me. I got physically assaulted in a Pokémon game. He didn't challenge me to a battle or nothing. Who is that guy? Anyways, we're talking to the professor of this game, Professor Elm. You can tell he's a professor because he's named after a tree, just like Oak. So does anyone out there know why Professor Elm was not in the intro cutscene to this game, instead it was Professor Oak like in the original generation? He's so bland that even the game designers didn't want to put him in the intro cutscene. Ah, but before I forget myself, let's introduce the three characters for this playthrough. First up is Gold, who is going to choose Cyndaquil as his starter. I haven't used Cyndaquil in so long that he actually managed to surprise me in just this first video alone, so stay tuned for that. Next up on our list, we have Silver, who will be choosing Totodile. Totodile is favored by the speedrunners of this game. I have no idea if he's better than Cyndaquil casually, so I suppose that'll also be something worth discovering. Now as for Crystal Version, this was the first game in the entire series to let you pick a female trainer, which I'm sure everyone did just to try it out. This lady is named Chris, and it's probably short for Crystal Meth because she's gonna choose the grass starter. Look, I like the Chikorita line design-wise, but grass is really just not a favorable type in the early part of this game. But who knows, right? She might even surprise us. Anyways, after choosing our starter, we get to run an errand for the local professor, just like in Generation 1. However, this time we get the errand at the start of the adventure instead of slightly after the beginning. It's kind of a little more convenient knowing from the start what we're meant to do. And in this game, we also get a free potion from the professor's aid instead of finding one in our PC storage system randomly. What was that potion doing there in the first game, I swear? I mean, it's not like my mom decided to sneak it in there. Anyways, the journey has officially begun. I'm walking through the grass, trying not to find any encounters. I'm hoping for no encounters because it takes up a bunch of time, and even though I could get experience before even finding any trainers, I would like to encounter something on the very final grass tile I had to pass through. How nice. Anyways, you can see the battle system really hasn't changed. You can see that we now have genders for our Pokémon. Not all Pokémon have genders, and some have interesting genders, let's say. But while Gold is fighting off a random Pidgey, let's switch over to Silver. Now, here we see a new feature of Gold and Silver. There is now a day-night cycle. Depending on what time of the game you are playing, you can encounter different Pokémon. Also, note the back sprite for Silver. I drew that myself. It's not really good, but whatever. Anyways, I'm a bit hit or miss on the whole day-night thing. On the one hand, it's a really great detail and makes the world feel alive. However, by making it so that certain Pokémon only appear at night or in the morning, that kind of forces players to play at certain times of the day if they want to collect all the Pokémon. I mean, I tried to collect all of the Pokémon that were available to me this early in the game across the three playthroughs. I am, of course, playing this on emulator, and I have the game's clock synced to my computer clock. So what happened was, in order to get some of the encounters that only occur in the morning, I had to wake up at like 10 a.m. just to play Pokémon, because that's when the game considers it to be morning. So they have morning encounters, night encounters, and afternoon encounters. Could get a little overwhelming. What's more, you now have trees that only bear fruit every 24 hours, so if you want to collect a lot of berries, that's gonna be a bit of a grind too. Ah yes, I should explain berries as well. Berries are a type of hold item, which is a new feature in Generation 2. You can make your Pokémon hold one item, which they might use in the middle of a battle. In the case of the berry, it will automatically heal 10 HP once you fall below a certain health threshold, and the advantage of this is that the berry does not use up a turn like a potion would. However, once it's consumed, then your Pokémon is holding nothing, and you will have to re-equip them with a new berry. There are also hold items with passive effects that aren't consumable, and there's not really a great variety of hold items in Generation 2, but we'll pick up and use what we can. Anyways, I viewed that tutorial because that's the only way to get the town map. I've actually gone through an entire playthrough of this game without ever having a town map because I didn't know that's how you would get it. So this game opens up with a fetch quest. We have to get something from a guy called Mr. Pokémon. I have no idea why he's called that, it never really comes up. Anyways, he lives out in the middle of nowhere, up this route. I have no idea why he lives here, but on the way there, there was a house with a guy who will give you a free berry. So, might as well stock up on those while I can. And you're actually not allowed to have any Pokeballs while you're doing all of this, by the way. We don't have the Pokedex or balls yet. So, you know, if you get a rare encounter or anything, you're kind of out of luck. And while there aren't really any rare Pokemon available at the moment, there is a certain feature that was added to Generation 2. You guys know what I'm talking about. But suffice to say, if you ran into a rare Pokemon and didn't have any balls to catch it, you'd be very frustrated. So the item Mr. Pokemon has for us is an egg. You know, this was always a really weird thing. Like, eggs are a new thing in Generation 2, but you're telling me it took a long time for the scholars of this world to figure out that Pokemon lay eggs? What were they doing before Generation 2? Were they just, like, not intruding on any layers with eggs in them? Oh, and Professor Oak is here as well. He's going to give us the usual task of completing the Pokédex. Very convenient for him to be here. I wonder what we would have done if we hadn't received the Pokédex here. Would Elm have to give us one? Anyways, completing the Pokédex is actually impossible without access to Generation 1, so it's a good thing you can trade Pokémon from Generation 1 to 2. If we couldn't do that, it would actually be 100% impossible to complete the Pokédex. So there it is. Anyways, after a quick heal from Mr. Pokémon, we step outside and get a call from Professor Elm. And it does not sound anything like good news, we should probably head back to New Barktown straight away. I mean, we were going to do that anyways, but now there's a sense of urgency. How about that? And on our way through Cherry Grove, we encounter this kid again. We saw him back at the lab spying on us as we were choosing a starter, and now he's here. This is actually our rival character for this game, so that means it's time for the obligatory tackle fight and the first trainer battle of the game. And he sends out a familiar Pokémon. Now, it's not difficult at all to put together that this guy stole a Pokémon from the lab, and that's why Professor Elm was so upset, but I actually really like the build-up to this character. This is a great introduction to a rival who is going to be a lot different from basically every other rival in the whole franchise. As for the actual battle, you can see that it's basically going to boil down to exchanging tackles just like at the beginning of Generation 1. This time, however, you can buy items from the shop if you need them, and you can also have a berry equipped, and you can also level up before this fight. You might even pick up a new move if you level up enough. In the case of Totodile, he picked up Rage, which, thank goodness, it does not lock you into using Rage over and over like it did in Generation 1. It still has the effect where if you get hit, your attack goes up, but you're not locked into using Rage over and over again, so soft locking yourself with Rage, no longer possible. Oh, and here I'm showing off that in the custom silver patch that I made, the rival character has been replaced by the main character from the vanilla version of the game. So yes, their roles have been swapped completely for the most part. So the rival introduces himself as ?, and we didn't get a prompt to name him yet, so that makes sense, but we're going to get a prompt when we talk to this investigator at Professor Elm's lab. So, how many of you guys actually input 3 ? as the guy's name? Because I certainly did back then, I thought that was his actual name. I think in this case, just having it be a static name for the character would have been a better option than letting the player name them, because I think they start doing that in Pokémon games starting with Generation 3. Oh, and they also probably wanted to stop you from naming him stupid things like Dirtbag or other insults like that so that the game always calls him that. Typical of a company connected to Nintendo to try and stop the player from having their own fun. I mean, it's not like the rival name appears online or anything, right? So this introductory quest of getting the egg and bringing it back is actually a bit more lengthy than the initial quest in Generation 1, which was to just get the parcel and then bring it back. However, this has been far more eventful, so we can see that the presentation is a step up from Generation 1 already. And once we get our 5 free Pokeballs, which are now not handed off to you as if they were secret items, you get them automatically now. We only need to talk to the player's mother, and we will be on our way to the first gym battle. Now, if this game taught me anything, it's that mothers serve a very important role in our lives. I'm not kidding, though. The player's mother in this game will actually serve as a bank, storing a little bit of the money you win from trainer battles, and then once she reaches certain thresholds, she can actually purchase items for you at discount prices. One of these items is a moonstone, so I will be saving up for that. Very important item to get. I have no idea where she purchases it. I'm pretty sure this game was made before you could just order anything you wanted off Amazon. And now it's finally time for the capturing sprees to begin. As I mentioned, they have 3 different sets of encounters, one for mornings, one for afternoons, and one for evenings, so if you tally up all of the Pokémon that are available to me right now, there's actually quite a lot, like 17 of them in fact. So for now, I'm only going to show me capturing the Pokémon that are completely new to Generation 2. Or if I capture something that I'm definitely going to use later on, and it's from Generation 1, I'll still show that for context. To be totally honest, I think that most of the people watching this probably watched the Generation 1 playthrough as well, so I don't need to show you guys me capturing the same Pokémon again, do I? I see we're fighting Hoppip at the moment. Hoppip is interesting because it knows Splash, and Splash probably sounds really weird for it because Splash was the move used by Magikarp, it does absolutely nothing, and you might wonder how a Hoppip can splash, especially when there's no water. Well, it turns out that in Japan, the move is simply called Hop. There you go. Hop. Hoppip. A little something lost in translation. And you see here that Chris is capturing a Spearow. Spearow, as it turns out, is actually pretty good in Generation 2 for the same reasons it was good in Generation 1. Starts with a very good flying type move, and even at level 2 it can still defeat some enemies. By the way, you notice that these Pokémon, they're starting at really, really low levels. One of the most common complaints about Generation 2 is the level curve. The enemies just do not get strong to match the levels the player is currently at, and part of that might be due to the player simply stacking all the EXP on one Pokémon, so we're gonna try not to do that and see how that goes. I mean, Chris chose Chikorita at the start of the game. I think she's gonna need more than one Pokémon for her playthrough. Also, Chris just captured a Fanfi? How do you say that? My brain tells me Fanfi, but the spelling tells me Fanfi. Anyways, it's found on Route 46, which is found north of Route 29, but you have to go there in the morning to catch a Fanfi. This is actually a new encounter added in Crystal version. There are a couple of encounters that let you get some Pokémon earlier than in Gold and Silver. Anyways, you can see that I've entered a trainer battle. Technically an optional one, but I have to fight this guy, right? Youngster Joey is a bit of a meme in the Pokémon community due to something that he says in Heart Gold, Soul Silver, but here his top percentage Rattata has fallen to Chikorita's Razor Leaf, which Chikorita actually learns very early. Chikorita picks up Razor Leaf at level 8. That's earlier than the other starters get their elemental moves at like level 11 or 12, I think. And Youngster Joey also wants to give Chris his phone number. And, you know, normally a girl would not want to accept a phone number from a random kid, but I think Chris is feeling a little generous today. So, you can actually get phone numbers from random trainers in this game, and they're all named, by the way. This is also a big thing. The trainers have actual names. Oh, what is this guy? Youngster Mikey and his level 2 Pidgey? Get out of here, man! Getting phone numbers can actually lead to trainer rematches and a couple of other great things as well, so we'll be on the lookout for that. In the meanwhile, we have the first of many optional caves in Generation 2. The aptly named Dark Cave is pitch black until you have Flash to light it up, but you can still capture the Pokémon inside. There's one in particular that I'm after, Dunsparce, which has a 1 in 100 chance of spawning with every encounter. Very annoying to find, and I'm not even sure it's that good, but it does start with Rage, so maybe it'll be good? It'd be interesting to see if they did anything with Dunsparce in the other Pokémon media, because, trust me on this, you don't want to see what they did to him in Generation 9. Just don't ask me about it. In Crystal version, you can also find Teddy Ursa in Dark Cave, but only in the morning, which makes him doubly annoying to find because, in addition to his low spawn rate, he can also run away if you take too long to capture him. Yes, there are some enemy Pokémon that are now capable of running away, which, you know, over the course of Generation 1, this didn't really happen unless you were in the Safari Zone. So gotta be quick! And finally, we have the nighttime encounters for these initial areas. A bug-type Pokémon named Spinarak, even though I think spiders aren't technically insects, so bug is a bit inaccurate. And we have a flying-type Pokémon named Hoothoot. Now, I was considering using Hoothoot instead of Spearow. Unfortunately, Hoothoot does not start with a flying-type move. It has to wait until level 11 to get one. Spearow starts with a flying-type move. I don't know why these moveset designers really don't want to start out most of the Pokémon in the game with a decent move that matches their type, because that really holds back Hoothoot in my opinion. It holds back Pidgey as well, even though in this game, Gust is an actual Flying-type move now. However, Pidgey still has to level up to get it. At least it won't have Gust if you catch one this early in the game. The levels on the wild Pokémon are just so low for some reason. Anyways, there are some more berry trees along this route. I've picked up a Bitterberry here. This is one of the berries that can cure a status condition automatically if the Pokémon is hit with that status condition and holding it. In this case, Bitterberries cure Confusion, and there's not a lot of Confusion this early in the game, but we'll hold on to it just in case. These berries, by the way, were all renamed in Generation 3, so if you're more familiar with Oran berries, Person berries, and so on, they weren't called that in Generation 2, oddly enough. Anyways, we've reached Violet City. There is a gym and a dungeon waiting for us here, so let's take on the dungeon first. We get an HM out of it. This is the Sprout Tower, very Bellsprout themed, and in fact the trainers here have 99% Bellsprout. Somebody liked Bellsprout just a little too much, it seems. and on this floor we meet the most annoying enemy trainer ever. This is called a spinner for obvious reasons, and he's the bane of speedrunners' existence. He just spins around randomly, there's no telling which direction he's going to look. So if you're trying to avoid trainer battles, the spinners are the worst. This upcoming trainer can't be avoided, so I would actually like to take a moment to commend the graphic designers for really stepping it up and making Johto look unique, as opposed to Generation 1 with all the generic buildings and stuff. The Sprout Tower actually looks like a Japanese building, and you go inside and find all of these Japanese monks. You know, Generation 2 really looks like Japan compared to Generation 1. It's a huge leap in detail for this series, and I really just thought it was worth a mention. Oh yeah, I also forgot to mention that there are encounters in the Sprout Tower. However, none of them are Bellsprout, go figure. Instead, it's just Rattata, and at night you can actually find Ghastly. I don't know why, but Ghastly is a very good Pokemon still, so capturing him this early is actually going to be really huge for Silver, who's doing an actual capture, go figure. Ghastly starts with Hypnosis and Lick, two status moves, very nice to have, and he can learn some interesting new moves as we level him up, so that's going to be a thing. You can actually level up Ghastly off of the Bellsprout the enemy trainers have. You'll resist their Vine Whip attacks. Also, does anyone know why Ghastly has that weird white dot in the center of his forehead? Like, no other Ghastly design has that, not even in Generation 1, so I really don't know what's up with that. Is there a reason for it? Anyways, I fast-forwarded to the top floor of the tower because, really, every trainer had nothing but Bellsprout except for, like, one Hoot Hoot. And we see that the rival is claiming his HM at the moment. I'm up next, old man. Don't relax yet. So, of course, we see the theme that is repeated all too often in Pokémon. This rival character, he only cares about strong Pokémon, and that means he's bound to lose to us multiple times. But I really like that they show him using an escape rope to get out of here. That was really nice, confirming that the other characters can actually use items like escape ropes. They aren't just a gameplay thing. Somebody really likes Bellsprout, it seems. I wonder what the reason for that is. Like, there's nothing really noteworthy about Bellsprout other than it looks like, well, you can, form your own conclusion considering the kind of moves it can get. It can get Vine Whip, it can get Growth. Yeah, whatever, let's just get to this battle. So you're gonna see here that I used the Bellsprout throughout the tower to level up my Spearow from level 2 all the way up to level 9. Just by fighting Bellsprout, that's how far it got. And it might not seem like a lot of EXP, but you know, I got from level 2 to level 9. I think I'm happy with this. See, this is what I was talking about when I caught that Oddish back in Generation 1. As long as a Pokemon starts at a fairly okay-ish level for the area it's in, has a move that it can actually use to fight the Pokemon in that area, then it's going to be able to do well. Spearow starts with Peck, that's good for the Bellsprout in the tower, and so forth. Ghastly can do pretty good too. Lick isn't really that good of a move, it doesn't have a lot of power. It paralyzes, which is nice, but its base power is still so low that if you try to use it exclusively against all of these Bellsprout, you're gonna run out of power points eventually, which is what happened with me, so I had to switch to Totodile to clean up the last couple of enemies. Totodile's doing pretty alright here as well. I mean, it has a type disadvantage against the Bellsprout, but let's be honest here, Vine Whip is not going to do much considering the level difference, and Totodile also has Scratch, which in terms of normal moves is stronger than Tackle, go figure. And as you can see, Ghastly has now reached level 11. Leveling up actually doesn't seem to be that painful in Generation 2, at least so far, compared to Generation 1. It was really bad in Generation 1, so hopefully they stay this course in Generation 2. And as you can see, Gold has Cyndaquil, and Cyndaquil has learned Ember, so you can imagine how the battles went for him. We receive the HM Flash, and oddly, we need the badge from this very city in order to be able to use Flash, but we've only really seen one cave that requires Flash at this point, so like, it's whatever. Oh darn it, I got caught by the spinner on the way out of here. Well, that's unfortunate. Unlike in a gym, the trainers don't automatically get marked as beaten just because you beat the boss of the dungeon. So, Nico, it looks like I'm going to have to burn you to the ground as well. Look at this, level 3. Get out of here, man. And I even managed to hit level 14 from this battle. So, you know, I've got a level 14 Cyndaquil. It looks like that gym leader will be going down relatively simpler than I thought. Wait, what is this? Cyndaquil evolves at level 14? Are you kidding me? That's like the earliest starter evolution I can think of. Did somebody make a typo here? I'm getting Quilava at level 14? What is this? The others need 16 and 18 and sometimes even 20, but 14? You know, I actually didn't know if Totodile really was a better starter than Cyndaquil casually, so it looks like I'm going to have to pay very close attention in order to find out for sure. Oh yeah, you can also get calls from NPCs you give your phone number to. They typically talk about, like, random stuff. But apparently Joey here managed to fail to capture Metapod. Like, really? Metapod is the easiest Pokémon to capture. It does nothing but harden. How do you fail to capture that? Anyways, it's now time for the Pokémon Gym. And the great thing about Generation 2 is that all 8 Pokémon Gyms use types that were not used for gyms in Generation 1. So here we have a Flying-type gym. I don't expect it to be difficult at all because, well, it's the first gym. You can't really expect them to put up much of a fight. But something that's unfortunate about this gym is that there are no new Pokémon from Generation 2 in this gym. I mean, they only introduced one new Flying-type, and Hoot Hoot is really not that much to talk about. But seriously, when you have 100 new Pokémon, you probably better find ways to really show them off. So those two trainers are just cannon fodder, as they typically tend to be, and I'm gonna outfit my team with berries so that I have some free automatic healing in the battle against the gym leader, Falkner. Wow, really, you couldn't go with any of the really cool bird names like Eagle or Condor. You had to make up some weird word, and it's Falkner. Okay, I hope you're not expecting a challenge out of the first gym leader of the game, because Falkner is really not that much to talk about. Only 2 Pokemon, one of them is a level 7 Pidgey, which is probably going to get burned real fast by Quilava here. Both of his Pokemon have a move called Mud Slap, which is a ground-type move, and it will lower your accuracy if it hits. And that would have been a way to counter people who picked the Fire Starter. Unfortunately, both of these guys go down in just a couple of embers. The second Pokemon is a level 9 Pidgeotto, way under-leveled. I think they really could have given Falkner, like, a much stronger bird than this. Like, they could afford to raise the difficulty a little bit. 2 Pokemon, 1 level 7 and 1 at level 9. You can see where the complaints about the level curve come from, because I'm way above level 9 at the moment. And for Silver, he's just going to use his Totodile to drown the bird instead of burn it, which is probably not that much better. You can't actually find any electric types unless you go further than this town and then come back to pick up the gym badge, but there's no real need to. One might be expecting Falkner's Pokemon to have flying type moves, and therefore Chikorita is a bad choice here, but only the Pidgeotto has an actual flying type move. Still, Chris Espiro just swept the entire enemy team here, and using a flying type Pokemon yourself is actually a really good idea because then you're immune to Mud Slap as a ground type move. Speaking of which, Mud Slap's secondary effect of lowering your accuracy is really interesting. So you know how in Generation 1 all moves except Swift have that 1 out of 256 chance to miss? Well, the same thing happens with Mud Slap's secondary effect of lowering your accuracy. The secondary effect is always supposed to work if Mud Slap hits, but 1 out of 256 times it will not apply even if Mud Slap hits. Really, really funny. There are a couple of weird bugs like that in Generation 2, but not as much as Generation 1, for sure. With Falkner defeated, we receive the Zephyr badge and the TM for Mud Slap, so we can teach it to one of our own Pokemon if we so choose. It's unfortunate that I couldn't really find any oddball strategies of taking down Falkner, but he is the first gym leader and a pretty weak one at that, so, you know, there's not much I could do to begin with. But there are still 7 gym leaders to go, and at least one of them is going to require some devious thinking on my part. You know which one it is if you've played this game. So then, as we close down the first episode, Professor Elm decides to let us carry around the egg that Mr. Pokemon discovered. So we're gonna be carrying around an egg with us, and it actually takes up a spot in the party because after you move a certain number of steps with the egg in your party, it hatches into a brand new Pokemon. I have thoughts about eggs and, you know, the whole thing that they set up with breeding Pokemon, but I'll talk about that more later when it's relevant. For now, we get the egg, we've got the first badge, and this has been a pretty good start to the Generation 2 playthrough, I must say. Even though there's not a whole lot of interest going on quite yet, I hope that you will stick around to see if the rest of Generation 2 proves to be as good or as bad as people on the internet say that it is. I am for certain interested in what the rest of the Johto region has to offer. I mean, I have played this game, so I know what's going to happen later, but I haven't done this deep a dive into Generation 2. So, I'm FRame225, and I will see you for the next installment of this adventure, whenever I can make it happen. Later!